physics professor of carbonates. And a fellow of the Royal Society and a bunch of other awards. We have known each other for 34 years.
I've never dared talk
something
about
like that. Anyway, since we're young. and today she's going to talk about one of the major evolutionary events in the history of life, the Cambrian Explosion.
Thank you very much indeed, Doug. And many thanks for the invitation. It's fantastic to be at SFI again. I was actually here nearly 20 years ago, so for a conference or a workshop organised by Jen Dunn and Doug. And thank you also for coming to this seminar, because I know that you have had a very intense week of talk, so I'm very grateful for your time. So yes, what I want to address is this quite profound but enigmatic moment in the history of life known as the Cambrian Explosion. I first want to credit my co-authors. I am a huge believer in international collaboration. In fact, I think science is an international endeavour, international social endeavour. So there are many colleagues here from all over the world, and also a lot of this world is done work has been done collaboratively, and is driven by some really terrific, talented PhD students. So that's I'm very much presenting a collaborative team effort. Oops, so I need to. There we go. So this is the world we live in at the moment. It's dominated by so-called complex life, obviously land plants, but particularly animals. And of course, this dominates our world visually, but these also have huge control on biogeochemical cycles and all sorts of other things. So it's an immensely important system to understand how these came to ecological dominance, how this complex life arose. If you were snorkeling over the seafloor, from about 3.6 billion years ago to 575 million years ago, you would see a bacterial microbial world dominated by stromatolites, such as the ones in Shark Bay in the corner there. And then something quite dramatic happened about 575 million years ago. We see the first appearance of macroscopic life. And you can see this comes in all sorts of shapes and forms. A lot is still enigmatic. Some we believe is almost certainly not animal, so not metazoans, but others are almost certainly metazoans. And this might be a real hodgepodge of, in other words, not animals, animals, even crown group animals. But by about 560 million years ago, we see the first evidence of mobility by these trace fossils, A and B. And by about 550 million years ago, we see the first probable animals that bore a skeleton. So in other words, hard parts. So hard parts, of course, are useful for all sorts of aspects of life, protection. I could go on. But there in H is basically the oldest skeletonized animal. And then, of course, from thereafter, from about 538 million years or so, we see this terrific widening explosion of diverse body plans and fossils that are now become very familiar to us, and things that we can slot into existing phyla. So, for example, the trilobites, arthropods, and so on. And this is the sort of Cambrian explosion sensu stricto. It's a crescendo of biodiversity, but also in form and function too. So this beautiful cartoon really just sort of encapsulates the rapidity of this event. The Cambrian explosion is shown there in pink. It's really happening supposedly over a very, very, or relatively short period of time in terms of the march of the evolution of life, in particular complex life. And it is often denoted as the rise of animals. But let's look at this in a little bit more detail. So here's a sort of timeline narrative of key events. So first of all, we've got the origin of animals as constrained by molecular phylogenies, and it's really poorly constrained. It could be, you pays your money and takes your choice. It could be anywhere between about 620 and maybe well over 700 million years ago. But so in other words, the origin is very poorly constrained. If the metazoa did occur during that time interval, they would have occurred in a very, very cold world that had experienced a series of these massive tropical glaciations known as snowball Earths. And there are two major ones, and then there's a minor one at about 640 million years ago. And after that point, the world probably got a little bit warmer. But lined up there are a series of our macroscopic life, so our record of macroscopic life. And a lot of these forms are really poorly understood. We don't really know where they fit into the tree of life. And that makes this problem, you know, the origin of the animals, the rise of animals, the roots of the Cambrian explosion, quite difficult to unravel. But if we put aside for a moment what on earth these fossils are and just think about what they show, so I'm sorry, the text is rather small, but if you think about these key features like clonality, biomineralization, surface locomotion, the formation of appendages, they all cluster there clearly before the Cambrian. So these indicators of complexity, if you like, both behavioral and other, are all, most of them are present before the Cambrian. So I would contest really on the basis of this alone that the roots of the Cambrian explosion are in older rocks. So these are the Ediacaran rocks. The root must be there before the Cambrian. Now, if we look at, so for example, one phylogenetic tree, what you can see is indeed all these branching points of these major, I'll just point these out. So these are a list of modern day major clades, if you like, and these are the fossil records. But if we look at the branching points there, all these bifurcations are happening in this older period, the Ediacaran. So sometime after 635 up to the Cambrian. So this is a critical bit of time to understand, in my opinion. And the way we've often approached this is that, of course, life doesn't evolve in a vacuum. The Earth is physically and chemically evolving at the same time. So the physicochemical evolution of the Earth, that narrative has gone absolutely inextricably hand in hand with biotic evolution. And there are numerous feedbacks and very, very complex positive and negative feedbacks that make this very, very difficult to unravel. But this is, in effect, the conundrum that we have with the Cambrian explosion, trying to understand the nature of this interface between how the environment changed, and maybe have created permissive environmental opportunities, and have life in some way responded. Did it respond in an innovative way? Did it just respond in another type of way? But it's this dialogue. Of course, life is not this linear narrative. It's not in any way a linear narrative, and there are mass extinctions as well, but it's this interface between environmental opportunity and evolutionary innovation that I'm particularly interested in. And I'm going to turn to summarize some of Doug's work here, and forgive me, Doug, if I don't explain it as eloquently as I know you could. But the one sort of very classical traditional way of looking at the role of species, how species diversify, is that, so here are these two phylogenetic trees, that we have a key innovation, which is often, you know, very poorly constrained, let's say formation of a leg. And then that leads to diversification, those lineages. Another option is we have that key innovation, and then something happens in the environment, something profound, that then makes that innovation more fit in a natural selective sense, and then we have radiations. And this environmental event, of course, could be something like a mass extinction that is taking away competitors. The classic example is the rise of the mammals after the end of the collapse of the dinosaurs. But what a lot of work that Doug has done is actually coming up with a different model, which is very, very persuasive. And this is the idea that simply we have a series of events that increase developmental capacity, and then there are these co-option events. These are now turn out to be incredibly common. And this is where basically a set of genes is co-opted from it evolved for one particular purpose, but was co-opted for another purpose when that became, for some reason, it enhanced fitness. So these co-option events, maybe other, you know, stages of developmental capacity, these can occur throughout this tree. And only then do we have the this morphological novelty arise. So putting this together, and I think this is possibly slightly out of date now, but if we take this scenario for the origin of animals, so we know that but basically animals, metazoans, had tremendous developmental capacity. Not all of it that we see today, but really quite a lot of the fundamental control mechanisms. I've just listed some of them here. And so these were just poised. They were present. They were poised long before we had any rise to ecological dominance before they had appeared in the fossil record. But we know that, that's a shared capability of all metazoans. So it's a very, very deep set of characteristics or developmental capacity. We can then evoke perhaps that there's some one or more environmental changes, and these then promote these co-option events. And the co-option events are, it turns out that they are really incredibly profound by mineralization, segmentation, nervous system, head, appendages, regionalized gut, and so on. These have all been shown to be co-option events. And what these do, in effect, is that they allow the independent acquisition in unrelated clades or unrelated lineages of these features. So these are very, very evolutionarily profound phenomena. And we think they're possibly constrained to somewhere in the late Ediacaran, but this is probably constrained currently. And of course, this doesn't apply to all of them. They're staggered. And then when we see the rise of the bilaterians, they come with a whole load of new developmental capabilities or capacities listed there, but some of the most important are these disc enhancers. But the point is that there is a decoupling of developmental capacity from morphological complexity. That's the point. And a lot of these phenomena of, if you like, that when these clades come to dominance, these are ecological phenomena. In other words, I think it's a very persuasive idea to think that to really take on board this idea that the developmental capacity was there, but it simply wasn't realized until some sort of trigger, which can be environmental or ecological. Hello.
Yeah, so naive question, since I don't know anything about this field, but it just seems that you have these trees and then there are these like yellow dots and the blue lines and the gray lines. How does that affect the structure of the tree? It seems like you're...
No, this is just a model. This is a model to show you the sequence of events.
Okay.
So the tree, you could have each lineage. Well, yeah, actually, Doug, do you want to answer that?
The basic tree structure and metals are dated with microelements.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the microelements calibrated with more recent fossil data. And then what we're trying to do is take geological evidence about environment and ecology and see how that matches with the microclimate base.
Okay, thank you.
This is just a framework in which to create these hypotheses to test, really. So in other words, I would contend that the Cambrian explosion is an ecological phenomenon. So that's really what I'm going to pursue for the rest of the talk, the ecological phenomena, and also how to try and tease apart what these triggers might be, mostly environmental triggers. So the favoured ecological environmental trigger for some time has been oxygen, because we know that the atmospheric oxygenation has been a very, very dynamic affair during the history of life. It's very important the issue, of course, is that if you are able to respire oxygen, you gain an enormous amount of additional energy. It increases your energy by more than 20-fold. And you can then use that energy for costly metabolic functions. I've just listed some of them here. Increased size, more complex body structures. You can place biomineralization under very tight biological control, and you can engage in very, very high intensive movement predatory activity. And also you can enter into an arms race where prey also gains an extra energy in that arms race. So just thinking, the first contention, very, very bold statement, is that oxygen at least has played some major role in the evolution of metazoans. So here's again a cartoon. You've seen this lower part already, but just added here, this is effectively a shorthand for showing the carbon cycle. So these perturbations, when they go negative or positive, show dramatic perturbations of the carbon cycle. And a lot of these, actually, both positive and negative, in different ways, perturbations can increase increase the development of atmospheric oxygen. So often when during a negative excursion, you're burying more organic carbon and pyrite, and that creates a pulse of atmospheric oxygen. So we now know that the history of oxygenation of the planet wasn't a simple, linear, slow build-up. It was actually a whole series of episodic events. So the early Earth prior to about, although this is contentious where it really happens, but up to about 600 million years ago, we had the thinnest veneer of oxygenated waters. But the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere was probably very, very low. It's really contested. It could be anywhere between 1 and 50% or 10 and 50% of present atmospheric levels. But nonetheless, it was very, very low.
Was the rest of it nitrogen?
No, it was what's known as ferruginous. It was iron rich. So it was anoxic. In other words, no free oxygen and full of iron. So that's what this symbol is. Ferruginous is green here, and red is euxinic, or with free sulfur. So free sulfur came and went at mid-depth. That's a more extreme form of anoxia, if you like. But most of it was dominantly ferruginous. And it actually turns out the...
So this is for water or air?
I'm sorry, this is the oceans. I'm sorry, I should have said this is the oceans. So no, the atmosphere had a vanishingly small amount of oxygen. Well, it had an unconstrained amount of oxygen in it. By the Cambrian, we think it may have been somewhere between 30 and 50% of present atmospheric levels. So the veneer got a little bit thicker, but you're relying on diffusion processes mainly to keep that oxygen there. And then we had these events that are somehow tied to the carbon cycle, burial of organic carbon probably, that introduced a pulse of atmospheric oxygen that allowed the junction between the oxic and the anoxic layer, which is known as the redox cline, to become deeper, but only very transiently. And by the way, just for interest, the deep ocean didn't become oxygenated until about 350 million years ago, which is probably due to the rise of land plants becoming more higher altitudes and all sorts of weathering processes and suck of carbon dioxide. So it's our planet became fully oxygenated really comparatively late. So we've been the critical interval is this interval just before the Cambrian explosion, because this is when really everything is getting going. So for many years now, I've been working in Namibia, in Southwest Africa, and there you have this tremendous outcrop, I mean, ridiculous amounts of outcrop with no vegetation, but it also records the oldest biomineralizers, lots of soft-bodied metazoans and lots of trace fossils. So you can really integrate this record together. So this is what the Earth looked like then. It was a Kalahari crater, and it sort of has a subtropical position south of the equator. So by the way, at this time of this bit of geological time, we had all these small continents. So for example, here's southern China, here's north China, and they straddled the tropics. And the tropics we know is a real powerhouse of where biological activity occurs. So what we've been trying to do is to test these ideas of the relationship of oxygen to biotic change and evolution. So this is a geological map. And what's nice about Namibia is you have these two independent sedimentary basins. So in that sense, you can test, is the record we get synchronous? In other words, is it being driven by something, for example, atmospheric oxygen, and they're showing the same record, or they're showing some independence, which means local factors are really overprinting that larger scale story. In geology, we're an evolutionary paleobiology. We're quite obsessed with time and time scales because it's so critical to get a time to calibrate these events. And this just shows you that we've got ash beds that are datable close to the base, but not at the base, the Nama group, but certainly at the top. So the time scale is actually pretty well calibrated. So what we've been doing is taking all these localities in yellow, and they're chosen because they're creating these shelf to basin transects through these two basins. So in other words, comparing shallow, going down to mid depth to the deepest parts to create a 3D redox profile of where the oxygen is, where the lack of oxygen is, and then obviously through time. So in other words, a 4D reconstruction. And really what we're tracking is anoxia and oxia. Anoxia, by the way, is a name of a Norwegian death metal band. Discovered that. So this is what we're trying to do. And this is a lot of work. Now, there's a whole sort of geochemists produce all sorts of proxies all the time that trace redox in some way. And you can choose many, many of them. We choose local proxies because we're interested in actually tracking local redox rather than global redox. So what we use is two techniques, and they're very straightforward sort of, this one is aqueous geochemistry, and all it is a ratio of the total amount of highly reactive iron, which is preferentially removed in the presence of oxygen, and total iron. And those are the species of highly reactive iron. And these ratios, basically, if it's below 0.22, it indicates oxygenation. And above 0.38, although this is about to be changed shortly to 0.44, is anoxia. And you can also differentiate between an iron-rich and a sulfidic ocean. Now, this only gets you so far because this really tells you is the presence or absence of oxygen. It doesn't tell you, it doesn't detect the difference between a lot of oxygen and just a little bit of oxygen. And the proxy we use for this is cerium anomalies, it's rare earth cerium, because it turns out that cerium, it has a higher redox potential than the ferruginous iron speciation potential, and it's closely allied with manganese species. So we can measure the cerium anomalies, we can infer this behavior of manganese species, and we can infer the presence of this low oxygen manganese zone. So now when we combine these two proxies, we can pick out sort of well oxygenated, although it's not a very nice phrase, but low oxygen, probably less than 10% present atmospheric levels, and then no oxygen or ferruginous in this case. So the details here don't matter, but I want you to draw attention to is this color coding. So black is anoxia, blue is oxia, and purple is this manganese low oxygen zone. So this is just a record from the very beginning of the NAMA group right up 12 million years to the Precambrian boundary. This is one basin and this is the other. So it's initially quite clear, although we only have data, you can only apply these techniques to certain types of rock, carbonate rock. So that's why there's some gaps here. But you can see, first of all, these two basins have absolutely independent histories. You could also see that life, these cartoons show where life is clinging to these oxygen areas. And it's clinging to the well-oxygenated areas. It's not adapted, in this case, to these low-oxygen areas, these manganese areas. And also, we see progressive oxygenation through time. And the cartoon just shows the position of this redox cline. It's incredibly dynamic here. In fact, it's very, very dynamic. You can see all the colors for the first 7 million years or so of the NAMA group. And then at about 545 million years, it starts to drop away and we have fully oxygenated basins. So there's evidence for progressive oxygenation through these 12 million years. So in other words, we know that these Ediacaran metazoans, we don't really know what they are, but they were really restricted to these tiny habitable oxic oases. And in this case, in this just one region, we see this progressive stabilization of oxygenation with time. How do the animals respond? Well, here's some metrics for the things that burrowed and trace fossils. And they basically took off after oxygenation. The redox cline fell. The surfaces, the seafloor became more intensely burrowed, and the amount of bedding plane itself was greatly covered. And also life tracked the chemocline. It started to go down into deeper waters. So in other words, life is simply tracking the availability of oxygen in this area. Habitable oxygenation space increased and animals simply followed it. Okay, so far, so good. But the second thing I would contend is, yes.
Yeah, and do you have any proxies for the microbial life along the escape gradient?
There's plenty of microbial life there.
All the way down.
All the way down. Oh yeah, I mean the earliest reefs which have these metazoans associated with them are or ostromatolites and thrombolites, loads of microbial stuff. The actual most of the cellular structure is totally gone. So we just have the laminations, if you like, and the clots. I mean, I don't think any really decent microbial things have been discovered. Yeah, the thing is also it's actually quite baked. It's been buried quite substantially, the NAMA group. Now, that was a sort of simple narrative for one place, but what I would also contend now is that actually the biological response to oxygenation is really cyclic. And that's no surprise. So as we've got this, we now have very, very good evidence for episodic oxygenation. Let's explore how life was responding to that. So the one thing you can do independent of knowing what on earth these things are is just measure a very simple metric, which is body size. Now, we know that there's huge variability of body size within individual species. And we know that it correlates with all sorts of aspects of fitness. The bigger you are, the more reproductively successful you are, you're a better competitor. You know, big fish eat little fish, basically. Now, this idea that then lineages slowly get bigger through time was put forward by the American paleontologist Edward Drinker Cope. And he named after him is Cope's rule, just get bigger. Now, when I was an undergraduate about 100 years ago, we all thought this was a crazy idea, and it had been absolutely disparaged. But then a nice bit of work by the Stanford Paleobiology group, they took all these major groups, so including vertebrates, and they simply measured, they estimated biovolume, and they put it all together through from the Cambrian to the present day, so over 550 million years ago, million years of history, and you can see everything is getting bigger. Slowly, it's getting bigger. This is a log scale, which is remarkable. And we know that that the history of life has had these whopping, catastrophic perturbations, mass extinctions, and we know that during a mass extinction, things often get really, really small immediately after a mass extinction. So they respond to these mass extinctions by getting small. And there's all sorts of hypotheses for why this is the case, but it's known as the Lilliput effect for obvious reasons. And if we look at some metrics of what's happening to the environment, so this is one metric called of uranium isotopes, and this is a global proxy for the amount of seafloor that was covered in either anoxic or oxygen. So basically, as these uranium isotopes go more negative, it means that there's a greater expansion of anoxic seafloor. So this is the Permo-Triassic boundary, the biggest mass extinction of them all. I recommend Doug's book on the topic. So the Permo-Triassic boundary, about 552 or so million years ago, 252 million years ago, and we see this tremendous amount of increase of anoxia coincident with this mass extinction. Mass extinction was probably a hypothermal caused by eruption of the Siberian traps. But a huge amount of rise of anoxia. And guess what? The gastropods all respond by getting tiny, absolutely tiny. And then it takes them a very long time to restore previous biodiversity and size. In other words, billions of years. We now know that actually this interval is full of anoxic perturbations. And it was a very inhospitable world for several million years. But the point is there is a correlation between oxygen or redox, if you like, and size, body size. Now, the Stanford group went one step further a year later, and they said, well, look, this is our current record of the history of atmospheric oxygen through time. It's obviously changed a bit since then, but there are these possible step changes. And they simply plotted up biovolume through time, starting with microbial aquatarchs and so forth, ending up with sequoia and blue whales. And they said, well, look, hang on a minute, there seems to be a crude correlation. So is there a relationship between the size of cells and the size of, particularly the size of individuals and the availability of atmospheric oxygen through time? In other words, things get bigger with more oxygen. But what about a high resolution scale? And what about what's going on through the Cambrian itself? So here I'm going to show you a data set from the Siberian platform. This is perhaps holds a third of all the biodiversity of the Cambrian. It's a huge carbonate platform, not unlike, I suppose, a bit like an enormous Bahamas or Caicos Islands. It was the third the size of China. It's absolutely massive, sitting there in the subtropics. And what we looked at is these four groups. Now, it doesn't really matter what they are, but these are reef-building sponges, primitive mollusks, an even more sort of primitive lower forate group and brachiopods. We chose those simply because we could get enough size data. And we simply collated the data for those four groups through time. Just to give you an important bit of information. So this is the Siberian platform, and this is a map of what it looked like in the Cambrian. So we had a reef belt all the way around here. We had a series of isolated platforms This is sort of behind the reef, probably fairly shallow waters, and these are perhaps deep waters. And that's what it looked like from the lower Cambrian to the sort of the late early Cambrian, if you like. And then at this point, we had a whopping mass extinction, first mass extinction of the Phanerozoic. It's called the Sinsk event, and basically all this went anoxic, hence that color, just showing organic rich. We lost oxygen, and it was an extinction event. It's not well understood. So just to give you the context there, so there, that's the Sinsk event there, this mass extinction event. But this is now just a compilation of one, simply the one dimension, a linear dimension, and I haven't shown this in the log scale in this figure, but just to show you that the color codes there, these different groups, but basically you can see they all show tremendous variability. These are the maximum dimensions of each species we can get our hand on. They increase synchronously at this point and decrease again. They actually increase again just before the Sinsk. After the Sinsk, you can see we lose the large forms, lots and lots of small forms, and then there's a bounce back recovery. So something is going on, something synchronously in the environment that's causing things to get bigger synchronously and get smaller synchronously. So pulling this apart a bit, the sponges, they get bigger here, smaller, bigger here, and here's the Sinsk. And these primitive mollusks and the hylids, they all synchronously show this phase. And I've just shown you there in blue the points when each of the groups is showing its maximum size, and they're more or less synchronous. But the brachiopods do something totally different, absolutely different. Now, if you look at individual species, even individual species are capable of responding to something. They get bigger and they get smaller. So these lines are just color-coded for individual species. What an amazingly flexible system. These things are just synchronously bigger, synchronously smaller. And we have the Lilliput effect, and then the brachiopods doing their own sweet thing, totally, but taking off amazingly after the Sinsk. So what we took from this, and this is work I did with my Russian colleague, Andrei Zhravlov, is that these metrics only get you so far. These groups, whatever they are some of them are responding synchronously to an external driver, but others are doing something totally different. In other words, the brachiopods, they're responding differently, even though they must have experienced the same drivers. So there's got to be an underpinning role here for different physiologies or different ecologies, different something. I suspect in this case, it's actually a differing ability to buffer oxygen. But in other words, a differing ability. So in other words, what we're staring into here is the guts of the Cambrian explosion. And it's giving us an insight into the dynamics. It's also giving us an insight into its demise, because all these groups, which look very unfamiliar to you, I'm sure, those are the Cambrian groups that hit the wall in the Sinsk mass extinction event. And one of the very few groups to get through, trilobites, the brachiopods, they are responding very differently to this anoxic event. And they form, they're the ancestors of all the biotas that come to dominate in the later Paleozoic. In other words, this is telling us that there's a real role for something probably physiologically, different physiologies in these early groups. They shape the dynamics of the Cambrian explosion, but they also help us to predict the nature of its demise because of their different response. So just going back though, of course, the point is this is cyclic. These are cyclic events. We've got, crudely, we've got two oxygenation events and we've got a whopping mass extinction anoxic event. And then we have a new chapter starting with groups that got through. Now, just putting this together in a little bit more detail, these arrows here show us when we think these oxygen pulses were. It's shown by these carbon isotopes and these sulfur isotopes, and these simply are showing you, they're tracking how organic carbon is being buried with associated pyrite. And those are both very, very powerful ways of building atmospheric oxygen in transient ways. These, by the way, are the uranium isotopes. The records, our record is very poor, but they're sort of following that too. But what I've shown you already is that we've got the size, which is these squares here. The size is increasing in one pulse, just in these reef-building sponges. So it increases at this point, coincident with this arrow, decreases and increases again here. So we seem to have these two points that are really noticeable. And by the way, this corresponds to species richness, absolutely here in red. In other words, biodiversity. It also corresponds to phases of increased origination of species, and counterwise, this phase is increased extinction. So everything is happening. All these independent metrics, body size, rates of origination, rates of extinction, they're following synchronously. So the next question we asked is, what is actually going on here? Is the area in which these sponges are living expanding and contracting with time with these oxic pulses? And the short answer is yes. So here's just a color code. Pale colors is very, very shallow, and dark colors is very deep, is deeper. So this is where these reefs lived, and these are sort of geologist terms in relation to fair weather base, storm weather base. But basically, coincident with these pulses, the reefs go a little bit deeper, and then deeper again. In other words, we can suspect that the redox cline is deepening episodically, which makes sense. You've got an oxic pulse, you're introducing more, you're expanding the habitable space, presumably laterally, but also depth-wise. So these things are just tracking, again, like the NAMA group, they're tracking availability, oxygenation. So that only gets us so far. So reefs, they basically waxed and waned in their extent on the Siberian platform following these oxic pulses. So finally, what about the mechanisms of speciation? So this is nothing to do with innovation or, you know, morphological or developmental capacity. This is just simply numbers of species. Simply, we have these three models, very, very simply. So we have allopatric speciation, where the original population is divided by a barrier. So the classic one is an ocean or mountain building, and that leads to reproductive isolation. So the endpoint is that sort of distribution. Parapatric, where you actually have a new area that becomes available and a community moves into it, which then speciates, and you end up with this type of distribution. And then finally, sympatric speciation, which is speciation within the population, where some reproductive isolation due to intrinsic constraint. In other words, it's invoking intrinsic rather than extrinsic constraint, leads to reproductive isolation. So it could be suddenly you have a different reproductive cycle, you're reproducing at different times of the year, for example. So in other words, you get this speciation within the population, and you end up with that kind of distribution. Now these are slightly simplistic, because of course this is really a genetic argument. Sadly, we can't look at gene flow in the fossil record, so we have to go with these simplistic spatial patterns. That's the only way we can really get at it. But to get at it, what we need is a very high resolution framework. In other words, we need to know how time is marching everywhere at the same time. And we need to have an area where we can spatially understand what species are appearing where. And that is the Siberian platform. As I mentioned, it's a huge area, and it's actually subdivided into these five little mini platforms, mini carbonate platforms. So they're like islands, if you like, imagine them as Caribbean islands. So here are these metrics you've seen before. And here I've just added now what we could do with these reef building sponges. These are the oldest major reef builders on the planet, animals. We could look at which ones were cosmopolitan, and they're found everywhere, and which ones were only found in certain areas. And these areas, the names don't matter, but they're simply color-coded. And the main thing to see is that you've got cosmopolitan species throughout this bit of time. In one area, which is around the Lena and Oldham rivers, it's like the sort of mother load. Everything is sitting there. It's the area of constant sort of spinning out of new founder communities. But this is the Lena Oldham here in yellow. All these other areas here and here, you only get endemism at these two bits of time, which are synchronous with these large size, diversity, and high rates of origination, and synchronous with these oxic pulses. In other words, you have these phases, just two phases of dramatically increased endemism, accounting for a huge number of species here. So this is the speciation mechanism seems to be is driven by this endemism. And if we look at these three general styles of speciation, The phylogeny is very poorly known of this group, but we can work out ancestor-descendant race relationships. And when we do that for the forms, we can find those four. You can see there's evidence of sympatric speciation, but these and parapatric, but the allopatric ones are only found again with these two endemic pulses. So as we can really start to pick apart these forms of speciation and the possible drivers, because the possible drivers is all synchronous here. Now, what's fascinating is I've been mentioning oxygenation, but a really critical part of this story is sea level change. So sea level is constantly going up and down on a geological timescale. You can see here, these are million year increments. And sea level rises and falls. And when sea level is very low, we call it a low stand. When sea level is high, we call it a high stand in any one cycle. Now, when sea level is low, it implies that if you have only a veneer of oxygenated waters, that the redox decline will fall off the edge of the platform. So you could hypothesize that the whole platform becomes oxygenated. And amazingly, these endemic phases are synchronous with when sea level is very low. Here, here, and there's actually a later event here as well. So this is simply, we hypothesize that these oxic pulses are actually in some way related to sea level. In other words, they look like these oxic pulses driven temporally, but I think the actual underlying driver is sea level, because the redox decline is falling off, and we're getting basically these founder areas, we're getting oxygenation into these outer areas, and that's allowing speciation to take place through allopatric speciation. So putting this in a cartoon form, this is the Siberian platform. These colours are all these isolated platforms. And the grey colour is just giving us where sea level was. So this white area here, white here, here, this is when we have these widespread speciation events. Synchronous was when the sea level is low. This is the Sinsk event. It absolutely, so the Sinsk event is between these two. It's actually in the Potomac too. It absolutely hobbled this community. The archaeocyaths went extinct, these sponges went extinct on the platform. But what you saw afterwards is the migration from the other continents here, migrating in. And then, a little bit later, coincident with the low sea level, we had the first endemic species here. So this seems to have happened three times. So our working hypothesis is that these are driven by these oxic pulses, but the oxic pulses themselves are related to sea level change. Sure.
So you're saying that the oxic region is basically this of constant depth from where the sea level is.
We don't know if that's the case or not. It may well have expanded as well, but it's to get at this, you've got to do a gargantuan amount of geochemistry on loads of different regions, and that's what we're doing now. So either the redox decline expanded at these points, or the sea level took it down itself anyway. I suspect it's a combination of both.
So I guess I don't know very much about the subject, but I'm just imagining that if you look topographically at the things where the things that lie in
exactly
the heights,
yes,
then
yes,
if the sea level went down and yep, the depths of the decline stayed the same, you can get some fragmenting,
yeah,
but also some unfragmenting, right? So
yeah,
lowering sea level can fragment things into different lakes or whatever.
Yes.
At the same time that lowering decline could
yes
unfragment things which were upside down islands before. So.
Yeah, no, I totally take your point. And if we could tease that apart, I think it would be very fascinating.
Yeah.
The one thing we don't understand, we haven't got a good grip on, is the... Yes, it's an obvious thing to do, to work out, are all these platforms at different topographic heights? That's unbelievably difficult to do. And you've got, this is all, a lot of this material is in core. We rely on proxy indicators of depth. And the problem with those is they are influenced by hydrodynamic energy. So, a classic thing that you get on beaches is cross-bedding. You're just moving stuff around and you're getting this lovely... these incline beds, but they don't only tell you about water depth, they tell you about the energy of the system. So it's a really difficult thing to unpick. And I took, that was the first thing I spoke to Andre about, can we get these different depths? And it's, we've tried, and it's really tricky. So just to conclude, I mean, this is, I've taken you back to a non-uniformitarian world. This is an utterly different world in which this is all happening 500 or so million years ago, 120 million years ago. We know that earlier metazoans possessed this developmental capability, and it wasn't until some, as currently not well-defined changes, there may be different changes for different groups, of course, triggered the Cambrian explosion. So I think Doug would agree with me that the Cambrian explosion is an ecological event. Do you? Yeah, good. Yeah. The oldest metazoans, which are in before the Cambrian, were really restricted to these tiny, well-oxygenated oases. The near of oxygenation was very, very shallow. But it was this dynamic behavior of the redox climate that determined their, it seems to have driven biodiversity and where they lived. We are hypothesizing the speciation events, at least on the Siberian platform, related to sea level in some way, permitting this extensive oxygenation, but that's just a hypothesis at the moment. We need to test it now with geochemistry. I think, personally, what I find very important is that we have to think about the Cambrian radiation as cyclic, not linear. It's not just a crescendo. It's really pulsing in a very interesting way. But overall, we can't, one size does not fit all here. These environmental drivers, things are responding very, very differently to these environmental drivers. And that is shaping the form of the Cambrian explosion. It's shaping the end of the Cambrian biota. In other words, its demise, which of course means it's shaping what comes afterwards and what creates the next set of biota that dominates. And this must have happened, you know, multiple times. Okay, I shall stop there. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I was just curious, like during this very turbulent period, do we know anything about the solar insulation? Is that also fluctuating or constant or what?
It must be fluctuating, but I don't know whether it fluctuates on any time scale that is, I mean, is, I don't think it's ever been, well, and of course what we have are these Milankovitch cycles, but they're off there, and that's in effect, you know, the caused by precession and obliquity, and of course the Earth is receiving different amounts of energy, but what happens there, it's just causing expansion and contraction of the climatic zones, belts, but that's occurring on a tiny time, you know, very, very high resolution timescale, approximately 20, 40, and 100,000 year timescale. So we're talking about really, really long timescales. We can't, in the Cambrian, you can barely calibrate these things down to 1 million years. It's very new that we can really put this into 1 million year increments. A single core, you can look at little fine laminae, and you can look at where they bunch and cluster, and you can come up with, you can evoke Milankovitch cyclicity through spectral analysis. But I don't think that has ever been thought to drive these big, you know, evolutionary events.
Thank you.
I think I have a fossil hunting question.
Mm-hmm.
I love your idea of the Cambrian explosion as an ecological event. That makes me think, okay, the Cambrian explosion was this huge explosion of diversity and abundance of animals. And it sounds like what you're proposing is a lot of that diversity was there in the Ediacaran, even if not in great abundance. But I realize that developmental capacity might not be something that fossilizes. Like, how can you observe anything close to what you're calling developmental capacity in the fossil record, or even if it's sort of some of the fully realized capabilities that might appear in the Precambrian, how likely are you to find them if the abundance isn't there?
Abundance is very, very important, but it's a very difficult metric to come up with. But you have the expert here in the room who is trying to marry this idea of developmental capability with the fossil record. So you can look at a fossil and say, okay, it's got bilateral symmetry. We know that this developmental capacity was already there.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a head and a tail. It's got appendages. It's got a gut, blah, blah, blah. So you can ally that to all these different developmental capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what Doug and I are actually trying to do this week with some of these weird groups. So these are all proxies. You're inferring the presence of that capability by the morphological expression.
The other thing we're doing, and what which is the early origin and development passage, really looking at comparing developmental processes of building taxa that we know diverge to point A, but the morphological expression of these developmental attributes doesn't occur until later in time. And in this, the early origin development passage, 2006, it's the origin of tetrapods, fish. It turns out that fish had the developmental capacity to produce mass, pointing to the fact that it was before it was actually evolved. You do that by almost without a lot of fossil evidence, just by using electron data with some fossil evidence, and then this comparison of developmental processes.
You can do that across living groups.
Yeah, so we're marrying molecular clocks with comparative developmental studies with the fossil record.
Right, got it.
But it's tricky for these groups where we don't know on Earth they are and they're long extinct.
So if I understood correctly, brachiopods are to deoxygenation as mammals are to asteroids. Why do we know why they were sort of countercyclic with respect to these other species and then were able to find the next lineage?
Well, one idea is that they can buffer low oxygen much better.
How do they do that?
I can't remember the deep.
Their metabolic system and the circulatory system allows them a greater degree of internal control over their physiology.
I see.
Than some of the other groups.
They can ramp it up or down, as it were, and
The other interesting thing about, one way we know that is that one real target of deep tides is to try and track ocean acidification events. You have to track pH, so the proxy for pH is boron isotopes, and the favoured carbonate grain of choice has been brachiopods in the past. But it turns out that if you actually target really beautifully preserved brachiopods and you compare it just to the lime mud, brachiopods, they're so good at buffering their internal pH, they just sail through an acidification event, show no change, but the lime mud is showing the change. So it's another, this buffering capacity has, it's not just oxygen, but probably pH and other sorts of other osmotic phenomena.
This might be more of a philosophical question. I mean, some people ask why the Cambrian explosion occurred precisely at the moment it happened and not before and not after, or let's say the evolution of human civilization, why it occurred when it happened and not before or after. And I mean, from your research, I see that there are many prerequisites for the Cambrian explosion and that you couldn't have that if there wasn't enough oxygen and many other things, and I guess something similar for other evolutionary events. But then the question is, do you think evolution could have been faster if chance would have it, or it has been as fast as possible to have the complexity we observe now?
I totally don't know. I mean, I don't think we know what triggered the Cambrian explosion. And I think, I have no doubt that it's complex. I have no doubt that it involves multiple factors that feed back. I mean, some people would say it's just a matter of tinkering with the genome. You tinker, and you need a lot of time to tinker. And eventually you've had that time and you get this. That would be a Nick Butterfield argument, tinkering argument. But I mean, this model that I've shown you of Doug's, it basically needs, it's a series of steps. You have the developmental capacity, but then it has to be, you have to have some other change, ecological or environmental, that means that the co-option events are enhance fitness. That's, so I think it's a series of, I personally see it as a series of events.
But the great thing about that question is that there's no way of being wrong to tell. Yeah. But that's sort of what undergoes a lot of astrobiology as well, is trying to figure out what is driving these events. Great. Thank you very much, Rich.
Pleasure.